when he had said this, he says to him, "Follow me." In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. One of these Wednesday evenings with the adult religion class, we'll probably go through this gospel. It's very detailed. We have two different ways in the original text. In English, it all looks the same. But in fact, in the text of the gospel itself, we have two different verbs for the word for love. We have two different words for knowledge, you know all things, but two ways of saying knowing. And also the way that we've translated feeding and tending sheep. We have two different terms here. And of course, because that is the inspired text, they have meanings. But it's not the thing that we're going to look at today. We begin with this last line of the gospel today. That when our Lord had said all of these things to Peter, St. John writes, he says to him, "Follow me. You come after and you follow after me." What our Lord is doing here, we considered last week already, centers around this charcoal fire. As we mentioned, it's the only places in this, many places in the New Testament, and in this gospel of this charcoal brazier. So this fire around which our Lord, in this case, has made breakfast. But of course, reflecting the earlier time, a month before, of St. Peter around the fire in the courtyard of the high priest's house. And these are both details that St. John, who is personally present at these episodes, desires us to know. They echo one another. And of course, the charcoal fire that's at the high priest's courtyard that we know of was Simon denying our Lord three times, cussing and swearing at the questioning of some young girl, some servant girl who was there. And there's a fascinating detail that I'll give you with, it seems to be that we can see from the text. One of the things that she keeps pounding on him when she comes back to him saying that night is, "You speak like a Galilean. You have a twang. We can tell. We know how you talk. You sound like you're from Mississippi. We know that you must be with him." So there's something about St. Peter's dialect, accent, from the north. And we know from other historical documents that in fact there have always been a distinction of the north and the south ways of speaking the Hebrew and Aramaic. But what's fascinating is St. John doesn't get pulled into that. St. John, who's recording all of this, doesn't speak about anything about him being asked any questions. So there are two things that the other second detail of is that the reason why John and Simon are even in that courtyard is because St. John tells us in the gospel that the other disciple, meaning himself, was known to the family of the high priest. So they just let him in because they know him. And Simon kind of comes running in behind him. Now this is a fascinating detail because the question becomes, are James and John, James's feast who's tomorrow, the brother of John, and the family of Zebedee, is Zebedee originally from Judea, from the south? And did they then later on move to the north to begin fishing on Lake Genezareth? It's an interesting detail. He's known to the high priest, the family knows him, there's a family relation, and knowledge at least. And so they let him in. And the servants who are there don't recognize any distinction to inquire about John as being a disciple. I just mentioned to you in passing, but it's a fascinating little detail that's in the gospel. And of course, Peter just collapses. He's being put on the spot. This is a night that says he's not been sleeping all night. They've been up celebrating the Passover. This is already going well into its 20th hour of him being awake and moving around and being alive, just simply being awake. And having this woman, this young woman, pestering him about this question. And we're told he cusses and he swears and he tells you he doesn't know. But our Lord had told him the night before, or earlier in that same night, because Simon, when our Lord announces the Last Supper, one of you is going to betray me tonight. Simon is the first one to pipe up. Well, even if everyone else betrays self-centeredness which always leads us into problems. And that problem, we know, of course, will be the denials that night. The other detail about this episode is, remember that the name Kepha, in the Greek, becomes Petros, boulder, rock. That this name is given by our Lord himself to Simon when he first meets him. Andrew brings his brother Simon, his older brother probably, brings him in to meet who he's calling the Messiah. And our Lord, when he sees Simon, says, well, from now on, we're going to call you rock. We're going to call you boulder. And Simon, of course, would be bewildered by this. This is not a name that anyone uses. I mean, we have Peters all over the place now. But at the time, nobody had this name. And this is an important point because of what's going to happen at this end of the gospel. And so when St. John lays this whole thing out, he begins by saying, when they had finished eating, our Lord says to Simon Peter, John uses his full name with the nickname that our Lord had given him, not just Simon. And we have to remember that what precedes this moment, remember the detail we talked about last week, that as they're coming in and they've dragged in these 153 fish, John is the one who says, or even shouts it out, this is the Lord. Simon just goes barreling over the side of the boat and swims the rest of the way, completely impetuous. But what's interesting in the detail there is that we're not told that Peter recognizes him, but he accepts John's recognition. This is different from a month before, when even if everyone else is a loser and betrays you, not me, here he's relying on John saying, this is the Lord. And Simon just barrels over the side. So when they finished eating, John gives us in the gospel the inspired text. Our Lord then says to Simon Peter, what our Lord is now going to do, and what we can admire here, is the great gentleness of our Lord to allow Simon to make reparation for this completely disastrous night a month before. And so that's part of the reason why he's asked three times about love. You denied me three times. Do you love me? But again, it's in different forms, this word. But at the same time, our Lord is not going to let him get away. This is like when the blind beggar is brought to our Lord and we consider it during Lent. Our Lord knows he's begging and he's blind, but he asks the blind man, what do you wish from me? What do you want me to do for you? The blind man has to say, in a sense, to acknowledge, Lord, that I may see. Acknowledge what is wounded in me. Acknowledge what is broken in me. And he makes him say, he doesn't just simply heal him. And here is the same thing. Our Lord can completely just forgive Simon. But there are two things happening here. One, as we mentioned, is the reparation. And the second thing is a lesson for all of us. Since the 1960s, we've really been into who we are. How do I express myself? What can I do? How do I exuberantly, how do I find myself, express myself, etc.? And that's fine, beginning with tie-dyed shirts, it's okay. But it's deficient. It's insufficient. What we rarely ask ourselves is the other part of the question is what am I? And what does God intend me to be in my life? Those are two different things. Finding myself, discovering myself, expressing myself, okay. That's part of the question of life. But the other question is what does God desire me to be? I've certainly told some of you that when I was in high school, I was going to the University of Michigan. I was studying surgery. I'd always been planning on this. I was always going to be a physician since I was a little squirt. And in my senior year, there was a sermon given on the second Sunday in the Latin calendar, which is Good Shepherd Sunday. And this sermon was on vocations, which is what we just simply did every single year on that Sunday, was we preached on vocations. Okay, fine. Now, I'm a senior. I'm 2 months before graduating. I have everything lined up with the University of Michigan. I even have a roommate assigned to me. All we're waiting is for the placement exams to get everything in place. Plus, I have this lovely, lovely brunette sitting next to me. And this sermon on vocations comes up, and I don't remember the sermon, typical of all Catholics sitting in pews. I don't know what he said on Sunday. But he finished the sermon with a rhetorical question. And he said, therefore, every young man who's in this church today has to ask himself what God desires of him, whether he wishes him to be a priest. Now, this was my moment of Damascus, being like waylaid off of my pew, dressed straight off the pages of GQ, a beautiful brunette, everything all set up, scholarship set up for U of M. All of the puffedness of the world and its vanity was mine. But that last question was not, therefore every young man needs to think about becoming a priest. Because every 18, every 17-year-old would just go, I don't want to be a priest. But he didn't ask that question. He said, therefore, you must ask the question whether God desires you to be a priest. That's the what in our lives. And of course, totally derailed my entire existence. To the point where I'm not doing surgery. I mean, I may be dissecting your brain Sunday after Sunday and causing you pain and vivisection through this attempt. But it's because I did ask that question. What? Not who. I knew in my arrogant adolescent mind who I was. That was fine. My puffed up vanity, I knew who. But that question came along and popped the who and said, you have to ask what. And that's what's happening in this episode today. Which is why John introduces it to the point where our Lord is asking Simon Peter, John tells us. But the question which is asked of this man is, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than all of these? After all, a month ago you said, even if everyone else is a total loser and betrays you, I'm not going to. So our Lord asks the question, but as I mentioned to you, and I have to mention this detail, and I have in past sermons too, the verb that our Lord uses of love, it's not translatable in English because we only have one word for love, but this notion of love is this adherence and a selfless devotion to another. Do you love me in this way more than the rest of them? And you notice that what Simon does at that moment is he doesn't address the second part of the question. He doesn't say anything about anybody else. But he says to our Lord, you know that I love you as a friend, as a companion. He doesn't presume to this self-sacrificing verb. They use two different verbs. It's translated as love, but it's two different verbs in the text. It's very clear. And our Lord says, feed my lambs. What? What is Simon, son of John, supposed to be doing? You feed the lambs. You instruct, teach, guide. And then our Lord asks the question again. He drops off this time more than these. And says, okay, we'll wiggle it down here a little bit. Simon, son of John, do you love me in this selfless, devotional attachment of love? And Simon answers again, Lord, you know that I love you as a companion. Doesn't presume. Tend my sheep. Lead them. Guide them. And that's why we now come to this mysterious part in English, when the question is repeated. Simon, son of John, do you love me? And then we have this parenthetic aspect where we're told by St. John is that Simon's upset. When we read it in English, it looks like he's upset because he's just asked for a third time. It's like, I already answered twice, what's the problem here? But that's not what's happening here. That's what it looks like in English. But the third time around, our Lord says, Simon, son of John, do you love me as a companion? And he's upset because our Lord has lowered the standard, and he's never answered to the higher standard because he's not going to presume to it. But when someone that we love goes, all right, can you just do this for me then? Love is being shattered at that point. If your marriage degenerated into a form where it's good to keep each other around because he or she's a paycheck and the other one takes care of the house, that's just a partnership. That's not a marriage. That's okay, it works, so we keep it together. So nobody considers that to be love if we just simply worked out efficiency. I mean, we certainly know a lot of people who live this way. But we wouldn't call it matrimonial love in the sense of self-sacrificing. And when that does happen within a marriage, we realize something's off the track. And that's the same thing here. Peter doesn't presume to this selfless love. But when our Lord lowers the standard down to, do you love me as a companion? Even though Simon answers exactly the same way. Lord, you love, you know all things, you know everything. Notice he adds it at the end. You know everything, and you know that I love you as a companion. He answers with the same verb in the third time. But he's sad because our Lord lowered the standard. But in becomes the what again? To feed my sheep. So there's this beautiful aspect of the who and the what that all of us have to ask ourselves, not every single day of our life, but certainly on a regular basis. That's the aspect that we pray with our hands open. We wait for the answers of God to show us not only who we are, but also what He desires us to be. Not what I feel like becoming or doing, but what God wants me to be and what He wants me to be. That's a totally different question, which is why then our Lord immediately says, under oath, amen, amen, I say to you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself, you girded yourself up, and you went wherever you wished. But I'm telling you that in the future, there's going to come a point when somebody else is going to gird you up, tie you, and lead you to where you do not wish to go. Now clearly our Lord is playing on some kind of a saying that was common in the day, because John has to explain it to us in another parenthesis. That our Lord is talking about the way that he would die in glorifying God. So all of this is brought together with the question of the who and the what, and then with the quotation that we began with today. And after our Lord had said all these things, a loud reparation, mercifully, kindly, but seriously to make reparation, he also pointed out what Simon, son of John, was meant to be. And St. John says that after he had said all of these things, he says to him, now follow me. The who and the what are essential. That's what we finish with today's grace that we're looking for. Is that God give us the knowledge about who we are. But that probably more important, what escapes our vision, is what we are meant to be in God's desire. What our lives are supposed to be. Then when these two things come together in our prayer, who we are and what we are, then we are ready to listen to that third voice of our Lord when he says, now come, take up your cross daily, and follow me. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.